Okay. Well, I'm excited to ask you a question first. Can I ask you a question first?
Sure.
Okay. My question to you is, because you've lived in Grand Rapids area all your life, when was your first experience with festival? When did you remember first coming here?
First, I remember coming down here is with my mom, my dad, my grandmothers, and my sister. And just walking through, because there's always tons and tons of people. And it was just so full of wonder to me. I mean, being a 10-year-old or 9-year-old, I don't know how old I was when I got with it, but I just remember walking around with my parents and getting yelled at for running off, trying to look at stuff, play on the swings, and get ahead of my grandparents and my dad and mom. So it was a lot of fun.
What was the one thing you remember most when you came down?
From that time?
Uh-huh.
It was the food booths and the people. It was always, everything was so friendly and warm.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, I was really didn't know what art was. But yeah, it was just a lot of fun to be around people and the music. And yeah, it was a lot of fun.
Why do you think your parents brought you down here? What was it that made them bring you down?
Because it was going on in Grand Rapids, I think. They really weren't into the arts and entertainment aspect of it, anything like that. They just wanted to do something to, I guess maybe to introduce me and my sister to it. To where, well, we didn't go down very much. We only went down every other year or something like that, because we thought we'd get bored with it, seeing it year after year after year, so we wanted to change. But it was fun. And then when I got in high school, and then I started coming down by myself with my friends. And then, oh, then the whole thing changed. Because instead of just mulling around, you know, we'd bring money, we'd go sit at the food vendors. Then we go from, we'd schedule it, we'd get a schedule, find out who's playing at what stage, at what time. And then we'd go from one stage to the next stage, to the next stage, to the next stage, back to the other one. And next thing you know, it's closing at the end of the night, and then we're all headed home, and it's just, it was just fun, just to get down here with your friends and just chill and relax and watch people and listen to music, and it was just awesome.
Do you have a favorite thing at festival?
I would say the stages is my favorite thing right now. Because you go, still to this day, I always look at the camera to find out if there's any bands playing, and I want to go sit and listen to the bands. Because that was the whole thing about it. You know, that's what I loved about it, is to go see your friends who are in a band play. Yeah, I know them, you know, they're superstars. Even though now it's not that bad, but you know, I don't know a lot of guys my age that are still playing in this circuit over here, but it was fun when you're younger and seeing your friends up there on stage and just say, yeah, it's cool.
So how did you feel? Because you never really said, and I want you to be really honest, how did you feel when I came home and said they offered me the opportunity to be co-chair?
I was excited.
Really?
Really? Heck yeah, that's awesome. It was something that I knew you'd thrive in.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and you are an arts person, and this is the arts mecca of Grand Rapids. You know, everything, at least at that time, before learn, you know, being in it for a while, you learn everything there is about art festival and what it's about, and seeing you get excited about stuff, seeing you get involved and hearing all about everything that goes around into bringing festival about, it was just so interesting for me. And a lot of fun too, you could be part of it, because we came down here for the weekends and for those 3 years, and every weekend and it was just nice. It's just a place to just come downtown and chill and relax. And to this day, I still like coming down here to chill and relax.
What is it like being a, because they always say, you know, you're a festival widow, basically, when your spouse is a co-chair. What was it like to be that spouse, that person who was married to the co-chair?
I guess you have a little bit of anonymity, because you can go around and only certain people know you're married to the co-chair. And then when you're talking to someone and they know you're married to the co-chair, and then the people that are around you that work at Fed, then all of a sudden, the whole environment changes. And I like that. I like the anonymity. I like not them not knowing that I was your husband, because that way they were themselves, and they're not worried that I'm going to go run off. They did this wrong, you know, and this is... I just love the... just to come down here with it, you know, be able to come down here. That's what I love the most about it, because I know you were going to be here, and I'd always see you and want to run into you, and if I needed you, I know where you'd look. And I didn't have I don't think being a festival widower was that bad at all. I always thought it would be worse, but it wasn't.
Do you have a favorite story of any time, like any time you were down at a festival?
One of my favorite festivals is going up on the roof of the building and looking down on the footprint of festival. That was just fabulous. Seeing all those people down there and being able to see what it looks like from up above instead of being on the ground. You know, when you're on the street, it was always so crowded. And then when you're up a ways, you're just that much more a step away from it. And it's like, oh, that's so cool. Yeah, look. You see those group over here, this group over here, and there's a group over here. And you can see movement. And I don't know, it's just kind of cool. And then, of course, there was the balloons. That was always fun when we helped with the balloons.
That was Alex's thing.
Yeah,
the balloons.
But we helped.
My fingers always hurt tying all those balloons. Oh my gosh, that hurt.
Yeah, but being there and seeing those kids' faces when you hand them the balloon, you know, and they get just big, huge grins, and they're just so excited about giving, you know, having a piece of a festival. And then when you got involved in the store, and then you got a different look. Then you got to see the adults get excited about T-shirts and mugs and posters, and it's just seeing those happy faces. That's one thing about festival. There's always someone who's going to be happy in it, because they bring everything together, and always something's going to make, they got something involved that either their kids are happy, so they're happy, or they're sitting to a band that they know that they're making them happy, or they're walking around and they find a new food from the food booth that they really, really enjoy. And it's just a happy place. The one time of the year that I think there isn't really a lot of negativity downtown. I mean, because the festival brings happiness. You see Sunny up there with a smiley face, and it's like, yeah, you can't help but smile.
It's always sunny in Grand Rapids.
Yes, it is. That is one of my favorite T-shirts. But they never had my size.
I'll have to remember that. So my best memory, my favorite memory is actually, I have a couple memories. Well, one was walking down around town with you, because I always like going to festival, because you always love going to festival. So that's always kind of cool. But specifically, it involves the girls. The one time when we got their face painted, and we got pictures together. Remember that? And you took that fun picture, and we have it on the wall at our house. That's like one of my favorite pictures. And the other one is, I think I took a break during festival and was a co-chair, and the girls and I went over to the art museum, and they were doing the boats, and you could put them in the water.
Oh yeah.
Remember that? And Kara almost fell in. Like, lady thought Kara was gonna fall in. They're making the boats, and the paint is such that it's kind of streaking the water a little bit, and you can see the boats floating away, and you can see, and Kara wanted to get her boat out, and she was trying to reach in and grab the boat out, and she almost fell in. It was really funny, but those are the type of memories I remember the most. Like, the bringing the girls down here was the biggest thing. It was like being able to share it with them.
Some of the other fun is coming down here with you, just walking around with you. Those are the most enjoyable to me. You know, the girls, that's a blessing right there. You get to see their faces, you know. Mm-hmm. Ooh, or when you guys all stop to get henna tattoos and you're looking to see which henna tattoos you got. Mm-hmm. And then you're sitting there, and then you walk away, and then realizing that the girls, I gotta watch where I'm moving my hand, because smoothness. And it'll wreck the tattoo. And then, you know, and then it's like, oh, okay, all right. But then picking the right one. Sometimes I thought it would take forever for you guys to figure out which one you wanted. Mm-hmm. But it's just, that was the best part of festival.
Or seeing Jeff down here with the popcorn machine and always getting popcorn.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's not like we needed popcorn, but we always bought popcorn from him because it was Jeff. and it was my friend, and so we would always stop and see the family and visit with them and stuff.
Or meeting some of the, you know, past co-chairs that you've met down here, mm-hmm. and walk around and talk with them, and then meeting the new co-chairs for the year after that, and just meeting people, making more friends, mm-hmm. and yeah, it was a lot of fun.
The most significant thing on my year, my 2011 year, was that poster.
I loved your poster.
It was the most amazing poster, and I remember that. I met Alex, and he's like, "Well, you're editor around the town. You figure out the artist." And I'm like, "Oh no, I'm not picking an artist without you agreeing to it." Mm-hmm. And I'm like, got stacks of magazine covers, and I'm going through magazine covers. Well, you like this person? No. You like that person? No. And I'm like, "Well, you know, there's this artist by the name of Alin Gira, and I said, I kind of like her work. I said, I haven't been able to figure out how to put it on the cover yet, but I really like her work. Would you be interested? She's from Mexico." And of course, Alex is from Mexico. He goes, "Yeah, that kind of fits." And so we went and I showed him some of her work, and he loved her work. Mm-hmm. And we sat there with her and we talked to her, and she's like, "Well, what do you think you want?" And we're like, "Well, it's just got to be something fun. It's got to be representative of a festival. It's got to be this, it's got to be, you know, it's got to have the Sunny logo, it should have the calendar, it should just encapsulate the whole festival feel." And she's like, "Okay, give me a few weeks." She's like, "I got some things going on." And then she contacted me, and she goes, "Okay, I think I have something for you. I have a sketch. Do you guys want to come down and take a look at it?" And we walked into her studio. I remember going into her studio, and I'm thinking, okay, you know, everybody has to change the poster. Everybody, never. And we walked in, and we looked at the sketch. And I think I almost started crying. I literally almost started crying because it was such the perfect poster. It was so perfect. It was amazing. And it was like she encapsulated everything about festival. But the one thing she caught that we never told her was that Alex was the balloon king. And so she put this little boy and little girl that was supposed to represent us because we were the co-chairs, and they're holding balloons, and the balloons create
Sunny.
And it was like, and I was like, "Oh my gosh, you knew Alex. How did you know Alex is the balloon person?" Or I said, "Oh no, I said, I remember I now. I said, oh, you got it. Alex is the balloon guy. And she was like, "What?" And I go, "Yeah, they sell the balloons. They brought that balloon booth back, and they sell the balloons." And she's like, "You guys never told me that." And I'm like, "How did you know?" And she's like, "I don't know. It just came to me, and I put this together, and this is what I came up with." And it was so perfect.
I just remember the first time I saw the poster, I just loved it. You know, the black, the red. And it just jumped out at you, no matter what is mm-hmm. going on. It was just so much fun. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a fun poster, mm-hmm. and I think out of all of them so far, that's one of my favorites. It's mm-hmm. the top favorite, actually, mm-hmm. out of everything, because it's unique, just like you and Alex, and it was fun, like festival. I think that's what it's all about, you know, mm-hmm. the uniqueness and fun mingled all together, you know, bringing everybody from the Grand Rapids area into this, you know, to either watch their daughters dance or their sons dance or play their music or whatever else, you know, or being in a band themselves, or just be like me and be fans of people that are up there on stage. That's just what it's all about.
Do you want to hear my story about festival and how I got into it?
Sure.
So my first exposure to festival actually was when I moved to Grand Rapids. And it wasn't when I first moved to Grand Rapids. I kind of heard about it, but I didn't actually go until I was living in Ramblewood with Wendy Charbonneau. Mm-hmm. And she talked about festival. And she said, "Oh, everybody goes to festival. We all have to go to festival. It's either festival or the Polish festival. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to go to one or the other."
Yeah.
So she's like, "We have to go to the festival. We have to go to the festival." So a group of us went down to festival, and I kind of remembered. I was like, "Oh, this is kind of cool. Grand Rapids has this event, you know." And I never got to go to anything like that because I was from the Brighton area, And, you know, we didn't have those type of events. You know, we didn't really see that. And we didn't go, even though we were not that far from Detroit, we didn't go downtown to Detroit to anything. So it was kind of like an opportunity to, like, see that. So I thought, oh, that was really cool. And then I actually, when I became editor of On the Town used to host the Festival Literary Awards. But the year that I took over, my predecessor wasn't sure how that was going to work, and because of the way the switchover was taking place, he kind of passed on it, so we weren't involved with the Festival Literary Awards that year. So the first thing I actually ever was involved in with Festival through the magazine was the film awards. Mm-hmm. We did the film show, and I met this girl who was, and I can't even remember her name, she was so cool, but it was also the same time I met James Sanford, who used to work for the Kalamazoo Gazette, and he was a film critic, one of the premier film critics in the area. Mm-hmm. And so we put together this the film and video competition, and we did this film and video competition, and we had it at the Grand Rapids Art Museum, and I had to run the projector, and I had no clue. That was so, I mean, I just had to make sure the projector ran consistently. Mm-hmm. And then the following year, we ended up going back and doing the Festival Literary Awards, and that's how I met Eileen Schwartz-Studi, because she was kind of heading that up and getting that to work out, and so we did that, and we did the Festival Literary Awards, and so we just kind of did the Festival Literary Awards every year, and we were involved, and I would help Joanne Reeves with publicity when I could, and I would talk about the importance of getting things up and early and da-da-da-da, and of course nobody ever listens to PR people. They never do, and stuff like that. And I just kind of did my thing, and I didn't really pay that much attention to anything. And then that one year, Kim Vandenberg called, and that was the year she was like, oh, she's, hey, I was just calling to see, and I was like, yeah, we'll do it, no problem. And she goes, do you even know what I'm asking you to do? And I'm like, yeah, you're asking if I'll do the Festival of Literary Awards. And she goes, no, I was calling to ask you if you'd be co-chair for 2011. And I was like, oh, Well, I got a few people I got to check with first. Mm-hmm. And then that's when I remember asking you, and then asking my boss. I can't remember if I asked my boss first or I asked you.
I think you asked me first. And then
I think I did.
Then you asked Joel.
And
you
asked Joel.
It was
so funny. You and Joel were like so excited, and I was so unsure. And some of the people at work were kind of like, well, if you want to do it. And I just thought, well, it seems kind of cool. It's like the big event, and mm-hmm. when am I ever going to have that opportunity to do it again? And mm-hmm. I was like, you know, you're giving up 2 years of your life and a third to kind of help out. So, and I think it was neat. I think Alex and I had probably one of the last of the traditional style festivals of that, where the co-chairs could do almost everything, and it was fun, and it worked really well, because he was kind of that old guard who'd been around for a while, who knew people and knew how things run, and I was kind of that new person who could infuse a few things.
What I liked the most about Alex is that he was willing to listen to you. Mm-hmm. I mean, sometimes he might have been gruff on the exterior. I remember you coming home and being so frustrated, and the next time you have a meeting, he's right on your side doing everything for you, and it's like, wow, you know. And then vice versa, you'd help him, he'd help you, and then I remember we went to one of Fred's pasta things for the first time, and I saw my old art teacher there, Van Tim Romanus. And I go, wow, that's right, you're involved in Festival. I'd forgotten totally that she was involved in Festival. And it was like, it was just so cool to see her there, you know, for a while. And you know, just remembering stuff that brought up fond memories of high school and going down to Festival and stuff like that. And it just was so much more fun. And I enjoy it now, still, to this day. And the best part is having you by my side going through it. So,
oh, aren't you sweet?
Yes, I am.
Maybe that's why we've been married so long.
Yes. We've stuck together.
Yeah. So we stuck together real, yeah. So then we, it was funny too. And the last thing I remember Alex saying to me, you know, I know we've had some ups and downs during this event in the very last days, but whatever we do, we're walking away as friends. He said, we're going to be friends. And we were. We were friends through it all. And that was the best part, because he didn't want He didn't want to be enemies. He didn't want to be one of those co-chairs that didn't speak to each other after the event or have some type of conversation. And I'm proud to say that I'm still friends with his daughter and his son, his grandson, who are amazing people. And I'm really, really proud that they've kept that relationship with us. Because you do, you carry those friends. I always felt like the outsider too, because you have so many festival people who are so interconnected to festival and so much a part of festival.
For generations.
For generations. That I was not one of those people. But it was still, I mean, and I still got to, and it's a lot of those people are very accepting. And you have to learn, and one thing I did learn from festival is that you have to say your piece, and however it goes, and you walk away. And things just happen, and you move on to the next thing and stuff. I'm excited. I mean, the last 50 years have been amazing. The last 50 years of all those volunteers coming together to put on this event. And the fact that they have sustained it for 50 some years with just volunteers is an incredible feat.
Isn't it one of the top festivals run by volunteers?
It was the number one festival run by volunteer run only, or something like that. I can remember it was recognized by Congress. Vern Ehlers had it recognized by Congress for the fact that it was the only all volunteer run festival.
So that's
an amazing feat.
Yes.
But you know, times change and things change and people look at things differently, and it just is the reality of it all is that people just don't have the kind of time to volunteer and do things. So I think the direction that festival is going now is an amazing step forward, and really will secure it for another 50 years. So that Maggie and Kara can bring their kids down.
Yeah.
And walk through festival and try to catch up to them and hopefully end up at the emergency section.
or get them the special balloon that will drive their moms and dads crazy. And put it on their little wrist.
That's
our job. Put it on their little wrist and hand them and take them to the kids painting or the kids
block. Or get that lovely phone call. We have to take your daughter to the emergency truck because she put a staple gun through her finger. You're like, what?
Did Kara do that or did Maggie do that?
That was Kara.
I swear that child got into more accidents.
I just think she wanted to see the inside of the, you know, her medical.
Yeah,
she
medical.
Wanted see, she wanted to see the inside of the emergency vehicle. That's all. That's the one over there who's laughing.
Yeah. The other one's laughing at,
Or princess crowns. Mommy, can we get a Mad Hatter? I want to make a princess crown. I want to make a princess crown.
Uh-huh.
How many princess crowns? So somehow you always manage to miss what glue in. Like you managed to get around glue in. I don't know how you did that.
But I got stuck with paint.
Yeah. And we're all like, oh, we got to go back and pick them up. They're still wet. Oh, we got to go back and pick them up. They're still wet.
Yeah.
And you're like, how much paint can they possibly put on a piece of paper?
Yeah.
That was always funny.
And then their first experience with spin art.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought that was just...
Swingin' art. You mean the swingin' art?
Yeah, swingin' art. Yeah, swingin' art.
Mm-hmm.
I always call it spin art because I just remember spinning it.
Like a spirograph.
A spirograph, yeah. And it's like, it was... And then meeting people who helped put that together and finding out about the everything that they put into it, you know, the physics and stuff like that they used in order to create it, was just fabulous.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that stays around for years and years because that's a lot of fun, too.
That's amazing. That's an amazing thing. I remember them coming. I remember, you know, because the tables, people don't understand how heavy those tables are and that you can't have a young person in that and stuff. But yeah, and you ran that. You were a co-chair. You were the chair for that for two years?
2 years, yeah.
2 years and stuff.
Yeah.
It was a lot of work.
Yeah, 1 year I did it with somebody else, and 1 year I did it by myself, and it was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just, you need the people that want to bring their kids in there, and then you got to watch, because little ones don't pay attention to the other three tables that are swinging over there, you know, and then that's where the danger comes in, because they go... And they jump back because then they want to watch it. Well, then that other table might come back and might hit them. So you had to keep an eye on it.
Mm-hmm.
And parents, some parents didn't understand the danger that their kids were in there.
Mm-hmm.
And they get mad when you say, oh, you can only have one child in there at a time. Your other child have to stay over here. And then you can take one child at a time and do it, you know. But a lot of people didn't understand it. But that's the danger that it had. You didn't want to have a kid get his head hit. And because they're at the right height. The little ones are at the right height that they just get the top of their crown of their head.
Yeah.
They can be hurt.
But it was cool. The patterns were cool. Mm-hmm. And how they did all of that. I'll have to talk to the LIT sometime and see if I can get them to talk about that and how they did all that.
That would be interesting to find out how their dad came up with that idea.
Mm-hmm. You know? That's it. I know it's a lot of work to put up, but people look for it. I remember you were closing it down and we were pretty much closed down and you were trying to get everything together and this guy came up and he goes, oh, and he had his two friends with him and he goes, oh, this is something I did every year when I was young with my family. And he said, I used to do swinging. He says, please, could we please? And you were so sweet and you opened the gate up for him so they could come in and him doing it. And it was like seeing that little kid again. I could see him 10 years old or 11 years old standing with his dad pushing that cement to make the picture go. And you're like, he was just like right back in that time period. And that was really cool.
Some of the adults that come in, that's all it's about. It's about remembering their childhood. Oh, yeah, we used to do it this way. Let's see if I can do that again. And they get the table going. So they get how they're going, and then they knock the pen down so that it starts to draw. Mm-hmm. And then they get the patterns on it. And it's just, you can see their eyes tell in their mind's eye what they want to do because of how the table's moving or where they get to move it. And some of them slow it down so they can get it and move it in and out. And it was just ingenious. Mm-hmm. So much more fun. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a lot of good memories. A lot of fun. Food. All the food. I was never, the Greek food, the souvlaki, is good. It just wasn't always my favorite food. I always liked, you know, to try everything. I remember Bob. Remember Bob from finance? Mm-hmm. Do you remember Big Bob? Him and his goal of trying to eat at every food booth. And I kept thinking, oh my Lord, I'm going to have so sick. But he did. He would almost get to every food booth and try everything. I was like, oh my gosh, that was amazing.
And well, it's just to go down there and, you had the Chinese food, and you had the Lebanese food, and then you had the Greek food, and then you had some of the other nationalities' food down there, and just trying the different foods. Mm-hmm. And, oh, this is real heavy. Oh, this is real light. Oh, I like this one. Maybe next year I'll try that again. Mm-hmm. Or then you go with my daughter's favorite. And your
foot-long hot dogs.
Mm-hmm. And elephant ears.
Elephant ears. Foot-long hot dogs, elephant ears.
Mm-hmm.
Ice cream.
Ice cream, yeah.
Does the Dutch group having the ice cream again?
Yeah.
You have all this variety of food, and you want foot-long hot dogs and ice cream.
And to this day,
foot-long hot dogs and ice cream.
Or elephant ears.
And we're all like, okay. Some things change. Some things never do.
Yeah.
So.
She came out down here with her friend the other day, right? Mm-hmm. And I just looked at some of the pictures that they drew, you know. They did the adult painting and stuff like that. And it's just, she just looked like she had a great time when she was down here by herself. That, to me, is even more exciting. Mm-hmm. To see our daughters grow up and come down here on their own with their friends and stuff like that, and then create those memories that are so fond to me.
Yeah,
being down here with my friends.
It's like we created the circle. Like, we went, you went as a kid, I came, we went as parent, as singles, then we went as parents, then we went as parents with older kids, and now our daughter is going on her own and showing it to her friends and checking it out.
Yeah.
And yeah, we've completed that circle.
Yeah.
And stuff. So.
It's cool, the whole cool circle. I mean, not the whole cool circle, you know, because I started with my grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
So to be complete the full circle, we'll have to be walking around here with our grandkids.
Yeah, that'd be another 20
But that's down the road. Yeah, that's close to closing the circle, but not there yet. We still have a high schooler.
Yeah, so we'll get there. But, yeah. Maybe else we can think of? I mean,
just when you did your 2011 series, and then it was interesting because all the people that you had to talk to, and then going around with you when you're asking people if they're going to come around to the next year's festival and stuff like that, and meet the new co-chairs and stuff like that, and then meeting the Teardown crew. I never met the Teardown before until you were in it. All what goes into setting it up, because then we started helping with setup and tear down, a little bit of tear down. And it.
You're right, because a lot of people don't realize that this starts, that literally, like, well, the whole planning of it takes a year, but the setup really almost starts like on a Wednesday, and it goes into full swing on Thursday, and then so that everything is open and ready to go by noon on Friday, and it takes a lot. I mean, it takes, and there are people who take like the whole week off, and when you're co-chair, you pretty much have to, but you take the whole week off, and you're trying to get all of this done, and it's just, and it's amazing what these production people do and how they get these dominoes lined up so that they can fall right into a certain order. And then it's such an amazing process, because not only do they get them to fall in a right order for setup, but then they turn around and they have to get them to fall in a right order for tear down, and it's all a process. So, you know, how the vendors get out and how everybody gets going and how when they can open what gates and how this works and getting things moving along. So
even with the stages, how they have to have everything organized at the stages. A lot of people think it's easy, but talking to some of those stage people, they got to get, okay, you're coming in at such and such a time, so you need to be at this entrance at such and such a time so that we can have your stuff ready to be unloaded, to put on stage, to get going, and still give those people that are on stage time to get their stuff off and move. Mm-hmm. And it's a lot of work, and you know, and I give props to all those volunteers that do that. I mean, because that's such a wonderful thing that they're giving up their time for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's just like, it takes a small village just to put on the event, for a larger village to show up, and then a small village to tear back down. And it's amazing. You come back on Monday, and it's like, it was almost like it was never here. You'll have like maybe some stage pieces. They won't have the big tents up on Calder this year, but they'll have a few things, but it'll pretty much, the street will be totally functional again. And you're right. That is an amazing process that they've developed, right on down to just the minutia of what has to be done. Mm-hmm.
And then they rent these pods to store everything, like from the swinging art to some of the stage equipment, some of the.
Well, you know, and some of that is like Hyatt, and a lot of there's companies that actually do a lot behind the scenes for festival that don't really get a lot of credit for what they do, to help, you know, help this function and help it run. There's a lot of moving parts and pieces, and it's everything from some company who donates all the wood for their scrap wood. There's several lumber companies that collect up wood for the glue-in project and event, to paper companies that would donate paper for the paint-in, and the Kendall Alumni Association always helped with the adult paint-in. But this year Kendall is like heavily involved and has always been a part of festival throughout the years, which has made it very special. You just have so many. It's a community effort for a community event to celebrate the community arts for the community to come to, and it's always been festival, and I think that's probably what drew to me more than anything else, is you have all of these people, and then even now, like, you, when you're talking to somebody, you're saying, oh yeah, you know, I've always part of festival. Oh yeah, I used to do this food booth, or I went down and I volunteered this, or you're right, it's always these happy memories of, oh yeah, I remember my my kid used to, you know, love to go, and we'd go in the paint-in. I remember it would take the girls to paint-in, and it was like the one time, because they were watched, that it was a guaranteed 30 minutes that I could go run and grab something to eat and come back, and I would just say to the volunteer, okay, they're in, I'm going to go get something to eat. And they're like, you're good, and I'll be back. And they're like, you're good. And I would just come back, and you would literally see there was a whole parent section where we're all standing here eating our food, and our kids are in the paint-in or the glue-in. When yeah. We'd be standing in the parking lot, we'd all be eating our food, and y'all knew what everybody was doing. And that was the fun part, and you'd just stand there and talk. And I ran into somebody, I think a few weeks ago, and we were talking about, I don't know how we got on the subject of festival, and she was talking about, yeah, and she said, standing in the parking lot eating your food so that your kid was in pain, and I'm like, yeah, right there with you. Those are the things that we remember, and it's like, yeah, it was great, and maybe you didn't sit at a stage with a little kid for more than 2 minutes, but think about it, Mike, both of our daughters have been impacted by the arts.
Yes.
You have one who wants to pursue it, you have another one who's done school musicals, will always have art as part of her life.
She still likes to draw.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's just as important as Maggie's passion for music.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's the ability to draw, the ability to see what the artist is trying to accomplish with their drawings and stuff like that, and then music, the beat, the composition, what octaves that the people are singing in, and trying to copy it. I get the biggest kick out of that when Maggie's singing in the car. And one of the music comes on, they got a really high note, and then all of a sudden your ear's piercing because she's trying to copy the note that they're...
I like the harmony. I like when the two of them start singing in the car in harmony.
Oh, yeah.
But my thing is that, you know, Kara isn't even going to pursue... I mean, she's not pursuing art. She's pursuing science. I mean, she's a nurse. But she was exposed, and it's going to be part of her life. You know, it's like my mom... I would say my mom was a secretary, but she loved art. And so she exposed my sister and I to art and to music and encouraged that. And that was part of our lives. I mean, we were a band, because that was the only thing that my school had was band. They didn't have choir at some art classes. But she made sure of that, that we went to the art museums and we saw some of that. And I'm glad that we were on the same page to do the same thing.
Well, it's just like with my family. I mean, growing up, we were in music.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my sister and I both played in band. I think, and then I got involved in art and liking art like that, and then the dramas that we had at school. You know, you'd always go to those school dramas.
I think it's still important for the community because it's important for everybody to get exposed to the arts. And with so many schools unable to always do that or to provide that still, or so focused on things that aren't always probably realistic, that it's important that kids have the opportunity to come to an event like this that's free, essentially, and be able to sit and hear somebody sing and sit and see somebody dance. No matter exposed to other cultures. Remember the belly dancing from last year? Oh my gosh, I didn't even know that they could do so, that some of the stuff they did was belly dancing. I'm like, but being able to see all of that and being exposed to that, and I think that's the number one thing that festival continues and should always do, and I think it always will. And I think they've set the structure in place for it to succeed.
And it's not just that, you know, you get the, it's not just the belly dancing, but you got the storytellers that come around, and they're not necessarily on the main stages, but they have areas set aside where they tell stories, and they get kids coming into them, and then you get the some of the storytellers that are dressed up, and they act out the story while the person's reading it. I mean, that, to me, that's a lot of fun, too. You know, because you got all these people working together to do what? Entertain. And bring happiness to people and make people smile. And yeah, maybe it's for only 1 weekend, but it lasts a lot longer than that to some people.
Mm-hmm.
Like me and you, it's impacted our lives greatly.
Mm-hmm. It
and seeing our daughters both, our one daughter choose to play the violin. And then I think, oh, okay, she's going to continue with the violin. But no, then she goes back to vocal. And I hope she stays with vocal.
I don't think you have to worry about that.
No, I don't think so. I think she's definitely set on the pan for vocal. I think she wants to go to school to be entertainer slash teacher.
Maybe. One never knows what the future shall hold. Maybe she'll go to your festival.
Hey, that would be good. And then it would be, she can get more entertainers involved. Huh?
Maybe.
Oh. And we got the look.
I think we've covered about everything, haven't we?
I think we have. Oh, what is your favorite food to eat at festival?
Oh, that's not fair. All of it. Well, the biggest thing I used to always do was I always made sure to get some baklava from the Greeks, because at the time there was nobody selling a lot of Greek food, so that was the only time I could get it. But now there's more readily available, and then they have their own event too in August, so I always grab stuff then. So now it's just trying different things, and just, I don't know, it's just whatever strikes me at the time. You know, the other thing that amazes me is, like, I remember sitting in at a food booth meeting, and everybody's always concerned about the price, and when I walk around, I'm like, you know, it's not that expensive. When I get an ice cream cone here, it's not that much more expensive. I mean, it may be 25 or 50 cents more, but it's really not overpriced. The stuff here is not overpriced.
But they're not being impacted by that, I don't think. I don't think they're being impacted so much by the price as so much as... the food choices that they have. Some years they do extremely well because they have a lot of food choices or vendings that people want to try. Mm-hmm. And some years they have some that are a little more rare and generic that people haven't tried before, so people are a little bit leery about what is this food and stuff like that.
I think there's always a problem, and it just depends on the organization and how they present it. There's been so many different variety of things. There's been things I haven't tried, but let's see. If I come down to festival, it's probably guaranteed I'll have an ice cream. I'll probably do something along the lines of Asian food because I like Asian food, and it always seems to be the most unique. And they've got some Korean food here that I always like. I guess I've moved away from the Greeks only because they have their own festival, so I can go and get it. Plus, I always go to their dinner thing, their lunch thing, and get their food then. So, it just, for me, it's always just something, I want to try something new, something different, but I don't know, it's just got to be...
A lot of those new, like the Croatian and stuff like that, when they have their foods and stuff like that, those are the ones that I want to try now, because they're different, you know, and there's maybe a lot of meat and potatoes and stuff in their cooking, but it's just, it's interesting, I just like it, I like the Asian foods, and I like the Greek foods. I can get the American foods anywhere, so I tend to stay away from the hot dogs or hamburgers or stuff like that.
But even the foot-long hot dog, I mean, how many people actually get a foot-long hot dog? I mean, yeah, you can get them in the grocery store, big deal. But to go to a place and get a foot-long hot dog, I think is unique. I mean, it's the same thing as, like, somebody was poo-pooing, or somebody said something, I shouldn't say poo-pooing, somebody was saying something about the elephant ears, and I was like, well, you know, a lot of places can you go to get an elephant ear? I mean, you have to go to a carnival or a big event to go to get an elephant ear, so it's kind of a rarity thing. There was one that used to sell hamburgers, and they did fairly well. And they were like, well, you can get hamburgers anywhere. And I go, yeah, but hamburgers are an all-American food. So it fits the theme because it's all-American food, and you're trying to offer an international flavor. And there are people who are traditionalists, and they want a hamburger. They don't want...
Or their kid won't eat anything else, and they have a hamburger. They're going to buy a hamburger for
their kids.
That's true,
too. So I think it's, you know, the variety is always really great, and it's always something you can find and enjoy. So at the end of the day, it's it's just a fun event. And it's the food. I used to always write about the food, and somebody finally said to me, you know, it's not just food. Festival isn't just food. And you know, you're right, it's not food, it's the stages.
Yes.
It's the regional arts. It's the youth art exhibit. It's all these things combined.
Yeah. Because it brings everybody together. Mm-hmm. And then the mingling aspect of is the food. Because you mingle through, you wait in line for something, you may strike up a conversation with somebody and they may be more into literary awards or the art, and then you start
dire
talking
eyes.
To them. Yeah. And you just start up a conversation, and it just, I think it helps bring the community closer because everybody can communicate with each other, because one, you're in a line for food that you both want, so you know you have something in common. So the person you're talking to can't be all that bad, because they may not have the same opinion as you, but you know, about that stuff, and they may be even more passionate than you are about a certain artist, or then you just, oh yeah, well, I didn't think of it. I didn't think of their art like that, or it makes you want to look at art in a different way, and it's just a lot of fun. It's a lot of good memories.